welcome back, everyone. We are going to get going. We have everybody. We didn't lose anyone. This is great. I thank you for holding on. As I said, that was an absolute phenomenal session that we just heard from, and it's just appropriate now to turn it over to all of that's great. I loved. I think it was Mark said it. It's education, workforce development, economic development. All of this has to be, what do we do from the industry perspective? I mean, we talk about change and we talk about workforce needs and how does industry engage and what's their voice need to be? How do we make sure that they are integral and an active part of the discussion? And so, I mean, I am so excited about this panel coming up. I can't begin to tell you. So I expect great things, guys. So I am going to introduce the moderator of this panel, Dr. Bryan Albrecht, who is vice chair of the Coalition for Career Development Center and president of Gateway Technical College, and one of the most visionary people I know. And so you can buy me a beer later, Bryan. So,
Jan, you're very kind. Thank you so much. And like you, the last panel really set the bar pretty high. We went from redesigning all of our state maps from sunflowers to cheese blocks. I read all of the chats that were going on. And now we have a light at the end of the tunnel that we must all strive for. I appreciate that. And I keep thinking back, maybe I'm too far down my career. That light just keeps flickering. I need to get more education and information behind it. But I will say the panel hit some home runs on the concepts we're trying to create today, and that's build a national consensus around the importance of career development. And certainly it starts with a focus on the student. And I would just say that the student at any age level, and we talk a lot about K-12, which is extremely important, but I represent Gateway Technical College, one of America's community colleges. And I can tell you and assure you that there are an awful lot of adults that need the same kind of focus and the same kind of support systems as they make their life decisions. And many of them are already in the workforce. So our panel today has really helped us think about how we can collectively work to not only support that sunflower, but nurture it in ways that it's going to allow students to continue to grow and take advantage of the opportunities that are put in front of them, no matter where they are. This session is really geared on an industry perspective and how do we create sustainable and successful workforce pathways within industry. So we've got a great collection of business leaders here. They're going to share some perspectives on not only what they're doing specifically for their industry or their organization, but generally across the board, how do we collaborate with our K-12 partners, our community college, university partners, workforce development partners to begin to develop that brand identity that is so important for this, this initiative. So let me just quickly first share with you that the process of this panel is going to work a little different than the last panel. We will monitor all of your chats, so please keep doing that. But I've set it up in sort of a meet the press roundtable. So I've got specific themes for each of the panelists. And then based on their responses, I'm going to ask other panelists to give their perspective on that topic so that you have varying perspectives from different industry sectors that you can draw knowledge from. So thank you to all of our panelists for being patient with me in this new process for running a panel. But I assure you that when we get done, hopefully we will have a rich collection of resources that are available for everyone. So just very quickly, I'll introduce our panelists. Allyson Knox is the Senior Director of Education and Policy for Microsoft Philanthropies. Allyson, thank you for joining us today. It's good to see you on the screen. Adam Lukoskie is the Vice President for the National Retail Federation. Adam, nice to see you as well today. Sam Bottum has joined us, Vice President and Chief Marketing Officer for Snap-on Incorporated. And Ron Busby, from CEO for the U.S. Black Chambers Incorporated. And Carolyn Lee, the Executive Director for the Manufacturing Institute Education and Research Partner for the National Association of Manufacturers. Carolyn, I'm going to ask you to start this discussion for us. And you've heard a lot of the discussion that we had in the last hour as well about the importance of engaging students and understanding how we can keep them interested and focused on their decision-making. And that one of the top sustainable workforce initiatives and pathways for your organization is this whole idea of informed decision, helping people understand what career pathways are, maybe specifically around manufacturing, but more importantly, how do we help engage education and industry around that common language to support students? So please tell us first a little bit about the Manufacturing Institute and why this topic is so critical for the economic prosperity of our nation.
Sure. Thank you, Bryan. And thanks to everybody, Jan and Leo, for organizing this and all the work. And the last panel, I think, set this up really well. So for us, we have a numbers problem, right? For manufacturing, the new Bureau of Labor Statistics JOLTS number came out on Tuesday, I think it was yesterday, maybe. Yesterday was Tuesday. And they said they found that 706,000 open jobs in manufacturing in March. 706,000 open jobs. So I think that's an all-time high. It's certainly the highest since I've been in this job almost 4 years. We've been hovering around 500,000 jobs for almost a year now, actually over a year. There was 1 month at the beginning of the pandemic that we didn't have 500,000 jobs open in the sector. And so for us, we have this problem as great as all the companies that are represented here and that are part of this organization and all this work. As great as these companies are, people don't understand modern manufacturing and what manufacturing jobs are all about. So for the Institute, the Workforce Development and Education Partner for the National Association of Manufacturers, our whole mission is to inspire, educate, and empower the manufacturing workforce of today and tomorrow. So we have this weird dynamic with manufacturing. Parents and the general public love the sector, think it's really important to national security and the economic health and well-being of the sector, but think it's dirty, dark, and dangerous and not for their kid. Or the robots are taking over and there are no more humans. It's this weird dichotomy. And so for us, we need to change the perception. We need to change the understanding and the awareness of the opportunity. That's what our Creators Wanted campaign here is all about, I'm so branded today. And it's really about how do we get people to see the opportunities that are accessible with as few as 6 to 8 weeks of training that then can lead you to a career of interesting things that are challenging, but are family supporting jobs. And so we've got to start as young as elementary school and work on that message all the way through.
Carolyn, you're so right. 706,000 job openings in manufacturing. It's almost overwhelming when you think about the need to try to encourage young people to think about manufacturing as a really viable career. This time of year in the education world, we look at people's front lawns, and there's a lot of these front lawn signs that say, you know, congratulations, graduate of X high school, or, you know, celebrating that level of success. Today, driving into the campus, I saw signs all over our community, not from graduation, but from Incinerator Corporation, manufacturer in our area for garbage disposals, all open job signboards. So if you work there, you get a sign to put in your front yard to try to help recruit your neighbors to come and work for you. That's how desperate it is out there to try to find skilled workers. And so I think our message has got to be ramped up big time in the area of career development in order to get the message out that these are pathways that lead to rewarding careers. And I'm just going to ask Adam to comment a little bit, because we know that it's true for the National Retail Federation that your industry is still adjusting from some significant disruptions as a result of COVID. So why is career development a priority for your organization? And can you give some examples of how you've had to kind of reinvent yourself similar to manufacturing to get people interested in coming back into the retail space?
Yeah, Bryan, thank you so much. And Jan, Spencer, and everyone, Leo, thank you for having us and putting this together. I would say I'm from a small town in rural Wisconsin. So the previous panel talking about kind of rural opportunities, I unfortunately did not have much of a program. So it was a lot of self-exploration and trial by error kind of after I left. And my sister actually also works for John Deere. So both of those stories rang close to home. They helped pay for her master's degree. So this all you know, runs very close to me. But from the retail side, I would say, we, like Carolyn in the manufacturing, we have, you know, hundreds of thousands of open jobs also, and we right now are experiencing incredible difficulties in finding work, and not just at our entry-level roles. I think one of the things at the NRF Foundation that we do is, you know, most people, when they think of retail, they think of folding sweaters, they think of that cashier, they think of the retail jobs that they see, but most people don't know that we support 52 million jobs in America, and we're in every community. You know, that box of cereal that person's stocking, it takes an entire journey, obviously starting with Carolyn's team and manufacturers, but then the supply chain to get it to the warehouse to then get it to the store, the person who decided what would be on the shelf, all of those things, those are all retail jobs. And a lot of the influencers who are helping people find jobs, whether they be a teacher, a counselor, a parent, a professor, a workforce board, when they think of retail, they're only thinking of that entry level, job. And so our goal is to help educate and inspire and really promote our jobs, increase interest in those jobs, and then make sure they ultimately have those skills. So that's been a challenge before COVID, and it'll continue to be a challenge. I think it was great as we learned more and more about, you know, the frontline workers who, you know, the grocery store clerk who stayed and helped stock shelves and all that through COVID. I think it somewhat reinforced the image of that retail is only those jobs, because we didn't highlight all of the people in the background that were making sure that was dealing with like meat shortages and toilet paper shortages and all of those things. There were thousands and thousands of staff who were figuring that stuff in the back end. There were thousands of staff figuring out how to keep employees and customers safe that were not really talked about. So, I mean, that's the thing that we're constantly trying to work through is how do we make sure that all of those jobs that are available, people have that understanding. And also, you know, most people start in a retail or restaurant type job. It's teaching Americans how to work. And retailers really value that store experience because you really get to know the customer. And so I would, to the second part of your question of how we've tried to, you know, evolve or reinvent ourselves. I don't know if it's really reinventing because, you know, the pillars are still the same, you know, maintaining, you know, customer and employee safety. I think safety has shifted in the eyes of the consumer to be a little bit higher than it was previous to COVID. And so that's just taking some adjustments within stores, which I think almost all of them have done now. We're also really thinking about the customer and meeting the customer where they are and how they want to be served, whether they want it to be on their computer, dropped at their door, whether they want to go into a store, look, feel, touch, buy it, whether they want to buy it online and pick it up at the store. All of those options have to be available. And all of our associates have to know all of those options because competitive is fierce. And if you aren't able to meet that customer, they will turn and go to the next place. And so all of our brands are really, really dependent on folks who can understand the complexities of the system, but also really engage with customers. Because again, our associates are working with five generations of Americans. If you think of all the political craziness happening, all of those people are coming into stores and those associates are having to engage with them or market to them or support and understand what their buying trends are or be very sensitive how they market because they don't want to get, you know, on the next tweet from someone and having their store get boycotted because they said something that wasn't popular to part of the American public. And so all of those things are really, really needing to be important. And they were all important pre-COVID. It's just a new magnitude of those needs.
Yeah, absolutely. I couldn't agree more. You know, so I come from the CTE world, and for my entire career, we've been talking about the image problem that we have in career and technical education. And I actually saw a couple of the chats. How do I get more students to take career and technical education programs to gain that exposure? Because it's so closely aligned with the career development process. And I know in manufacturing, Carolyn would probably recognize that we've worked really hard to try to build a new image around manufacturing. And I think maybe what happened a little bit with COVID, there's this blanket feeling that people say a small business is closed, right? And now, you know, we're going to find a new way to get services. We're going to go e-commerce or some other fashion. But you make a really good point that it never really went away and that there are pillars that still need to be serviced in order for all of us to maintain the lifestyles that we're so familiar and comfortable with. So you're going to have a big lift on all of our ends, but I can see certain sectors like the retail sector that's going to need additional support and help around important career paths. And Ron, I want to shift a little bit and ask a little perspective for you. Now, I live in Racine, Wisconsin, which is located between Chicago and Milwaukee. And we often focus on the disproportional disadvantages that companies and people of color have in relationship to the impact of COVID. But it doesn't have to be because of COVID. It could just be because of the small business focus that we have, and we don't have the same support systems on that. I would just really like to get your perspective on what the shift has been in the world of small business, especially Black-owned businesses, and how do we support career development and create further engagement processes like we heard from the first panel that are so important?
Great question, and thank you, Bryan, for having us. The U.S. Black Chamber, we represent nearly 400,000 Black-owned businesses. In America today, there are 2.6 million Black-owned businesses, but the conversation is, of the 2.6, 2.5 million aren't mom and pop, they're mom or pop. They're single employer firms, And many of those firms were left out during the COVID challenge because they didn't have payroll. And the payroll protection plan was really set up to make sure that the employee was made whole versus the employer. And so last year we lost 41%, nearly 500,000 Black-owned businesses closed between the months of February of 2020 and April of 2020. And many of them will never reopen. And it has nothing to do with the owner's acumen, his ability to work, his desire. It is really about access to capital and having the customers that they need to be able to support their business and or service. And so as it relates to making sure that the workforce of Black businesses are there, we look to corporate America, we look to our partners, both on the corporate side as well as the federal side, to ensure that we have the resources as well as the relationships to make sure that we have those young people leaving corporate jobs to now open up businesses. What we tell young people is, this is me personally, and I have two sons, we don't need more new Black-owned businesses. What we hear from corporate America today is that, yes, Ron, we'd love to do more business with Black businesses, but they don't have the size and or scale, and we can't find them. So to continue to open up additional small businesses is going to continue with the same challenges. What we need to do more is to make sure that the new business owner has the skills, the relationships, as well as the educational training from development skill sets to making sure that they know how to deal with customers, as well as to make sure that they know how to lead. And what great organizations like the ones that are on the panel with me this afternoon do a great job at, and that is making sure that their employees have the skills that they need to lead. Many of the U.S. Black Chamber members across the country are looking to make sure that our employees have the skill set as well as the relationships. And a lot of that is going to come from continuing business development and partnerships around the country.
Wow, you speak on some really important topics, and I think it helps to demonstrate sort of the intricacies of all of the relationships, whether it's what we do in the K-12 area, trying to help students make informed decisions, the support for academic success, as well as career success, the transition and the pathway initiatives from the challenges that we face in the workforce, whether it's upskilling an existing workforce or bringing new talent into it. And I think you've opened up some really big doors there for some partnerships for each of us on the call today to start thinking about where are those small businesses, large businesses, Black-owned minority businesses, and how do we establish partnerships with them in order to expose our students to the types of skills that you're talking about. I know at our college, at Gateway, we primarily provide occupational skill training aligned to industry credentials. But in a survey of our students, 60% of our students want to start their own business. They want the entrepreneurial experience along with the technical and academic experience. So there's a driving incentive there that we can capitalize on for young people at all ages around how do we connect to our community. You know, and I'm going to ask Sam Bottum to comment on this one, because I know, Sam, that Snap-on's a global brand, specifically to the tool industry. But what's not known is that maybe your CEO, Nick Pinchuk, speaks about this concept that we're talking about often. He's been quoted as saying that the American dream has not gone away, but the level of global competitiveness has increased. Therefore, we must invest even more in technical education. Can you comment just briefly on how has global competition influenced Snap-on's view of the importance of skill development and industry credentialing?
Sure. Thank you, Bryan. First and foremost, I want to say thank you to Jan and Leo and the CCD Center team for gathering us here. This is a great event, and I'm honored to be a part of this panel. But to your question, Bryan, the others have obviously touched on this, but the whole pandemic, as tragic as it has been one big argument, one big case study for upskilling the American worker. It has proven that whether people wanted to acknowledge it originally or not, that there's so many essential workers in the pipeline, as was talked about, that are delivering your toilet paper, your food, your medicine, or making sure that cars stay on the road for doctors and nurses and other essential services, that that really has been prominent coming out of this pandemic. And so in that, I think hopefully it, one of the positives of the pandemic could and should be the critical nature of these jobs and the critical nature of these essential workers. And hopefully that puts a dent in, as we absolutely need to do, the public relations challenge, the reputation challenge, that these jobs are in fact critical to America, are in fact an American calling, and that the importance of upskilling people, and as I think Mark was talking about earlier, thinking about pathways more broadly, career pathways, you know, when you think about global competition, Bryan, your question there, other countries, I think, hold a lot of these jobs in higher esteem. But often they have very select pathways to these jobs, where you have one pathway, you don't necessarily have multiple choice. I think we can do it better in the United States in the way, in the systematic change that Scott and Mark talked about around multiple pathways that people can explore. But we got to hold up all jobs and careers that are worthwhile as a national calling. It can't just be you got to have a four-year degree. That has not served our country well. So I think we need to think more broadly than that. And at Snap-on specifically, we are a manufacturer, but we spend most of our time in our customer workplaces, whether that's Monpa auto repair shops, whether that's aviation hangars or large manufacturers. And the single most important issue for every single one of our customers across all industries has been finding talent. And so I think that becomes all the more critical to the health of our communities, to the accessibility and inclusion of all Americans, and also for the sake of the country.
I love that. Yeah, the American calling. And I think that's what we're talking about here, building consensus around the importance of career development and helping people understand how they can choose a path that's going to lead to a rewarding career for their themselves, their passion, but also sustain their family lifestyle that they want to pursue. So credit to Snap-on for helping to build that brand, and congratulations on your 100th anniversary. The Fixers and Makers are right in our schools today and in our community, and you're helping to celebrate that. If more organizations help to celebrate the dignity of work, I think we would be well on our way to changing that that perception a little bit, that maybe these careers aren't as valuable as what we think they are. And Allyson, I know that you're probably facing the same thing. And I wanted to share with you a little bit some of the similarities that we're hearing across our industry sectors here, that there's certainly a skilled worker shortage. We hear that a lot, that there is a new set of skills in order to upskill the incumbent worker in order to stay competitive on a local or a global area. And Microsoft has been invested in this space for a very long time. And you already have identified industry credentialing, and you're very well known for your upskilling of your talent. Could you share with us a little bit about what are the important factors that led to that upskilling initiative and why it's important for you within Microsoft?
Sure, and I wanna echo all the other panelists in saying thank you for having Microsoft here today, myself representing the company. And what were the important factors in knowing that we wanted to zero in on industry based credentials and also short-term credentials? We knew that this is, they provide a win-win for the employer. Sometimes it's us, but of course it's many, many different kinds of employers. We saw through the pandemic just a surge of growth in the number of employers right now who are transitioning their businesses, small and large, to a more digitized way of working. And with that, definitely is calling for more basic digital skills. And so having a common language to discuss what are the needs with basic digital skills, and then, you know, what is in demand in terms of the other types of jobs that are growing as well. I mean, in data science, in cybersecurity, these are just general IT professionals, and the demand for the general IT professionals continues to grow. Infrastructure positions continue to grow and how they relate back to digital technologies. And so we want to have industry recognized credentials out there, and we are committed to it, like you said, Bryan. And in addition to that, we've learned that short-term credentials are really important. So we launched last June a effort called the Global Skills Initiative. And basically what we did is we took our LinkedIn learning courses, which are about 600 different courses, is just the subset, and we tied them and we organized them by in-demand categories. So 10 different categories, six of which are general, like customer service pathway, a digital marketing kind of pathway. So program management pathway. So some are just really broad in general, and some are very specific, like data science. Point being that we offer these courses for free to the country, to the entire world. And since June in America, we've had 23 million people visit the site. Now, in addition to taking those courses, you get, once you finish a course, you get an instant badge. It goes onto your LinkedIn profile. But you also have an opportunity to take the certified courses for a radically decreased amount of money, so usually about $15. And we've seen hundreds of thousands of people complete certifications. So we know there's an appetite out there. We want to be part of the movement toward this credentialing space. And we're inspired by actually the employers and the employees as we're all experiencing this incredible digital growth.
Yeah, so I'm sitting on the edge of my chair because I represent an educational institution. I'm listening to 23 million people going online looking at your credentialing sites, and I'm nervous about what's the future of education. But it is so important that we talk about these issues, because digital literacy, we've all learned it. We've experienced it over the last year and a half, right? That this is something we are all going to have to get better at and become more comfortable with in both our personal lives and our work lives. And so we challenge ourselves around, how do we think about the education that we're giving and providing to our young people? Gateway is 110 years old. And I can tell you that our data analytics program is 12 months old. So we need to ramp up our engagement with companies like yours in order to better understand why those skill sets are important, and what do we no longer do to replace it with things like cybersecurity or data analytics and new programming options and the exciting things that we all want to celebrate. So it's so important that we bring these issues forefront. And I'm gonna transition over to Carolyn, because this is a big challenge for us, right? We've got a lot of skill sets that we're familiar with in our educational environment. We heard some great things from the previous panel about the need for expanded career development. Can you just discuss a little bit, how do we build that bridge? How do we engage parents, teachers, counselors, and anyone that's really interested in helping create that new dynamic space between the rapidly requirements of new skills with the traditional delivery models that we're also familiar with?
Yeah, it's a great question, Bryan. You know, on the one hand, there's so much, right? There's not one manufacturing job, which is tough for us as we represent the entire industry. There's not one monolithic, you know, and if you do talk to the public about one manufacturing job, the job they envision is assembly line worker, right? And we know there are thousands of other careers. What we've done, and so many of the participants here on the entire conference have participated in, are things like National Manufacturing Day. Open the door, bring people in. They can't imagine what they can't see, right? They have no idea they can be interested in something they've never heard about or seen or been exposed to. The other thing that I'm always surprised about, and that's why, you know, the work of the CCD Center is so important, and kind of this entire movement, is, you know, every time I speak publicly, I'm sure many other people have had this experience. Every time I speak publicly, or we're fortunate enough to be part of some, you know, national newscast. Last week there was a piece on CNBC about our new work on second chance hiring, and I get an email. I saw you. I'm interested. There are all these jobs. Where do I go? And my answer always, because yes, the Institute has lots of programs all over the place, and our FAME apprenticeship program, and other work we're doing on the ground across the country. But the reality is we're not everywhere, and we're never going to be. And no individual organization here is ever going to be. So my answer is always, contact your local community and technical college. Contact them, because they should be in touch with the local employers so that they know what they're training for. And what I say to the companies when they say to us, we have a problem, we don't have enough people, my answer is, go talk to your community and technical college. Because yes, we can help you and we can do things nationally and we can deploy programs, but the infrastructure needs to be knitted together locally, so that when you have a student who's interested, like the conversation about the young woman with the welding program before, who went on to John Deere, it's how do you light the spark, get the exposure, do the class, take the course, whatever it may be, and then continue down the path. And so, you know, for all the Microsoft certifications, which are tremendous, and Microsoft is a great partner for us as well, the reality is we need data analysts and cybersecurity and all of that, you know, the tech stuff in manufacturing too. It's no longer, you know, a big burly guy just lifting up a bar and sticking it in the back of a machine. It's all technology. So we have to really think holistically, and we need to think locally at the same time, and we need to partner and bring the parents and the teachers in. You know, many of you who know me well have heard the story. You know, my dad and my grandfather were in manufacturing, and they'll say to me, you know, and my dad, who's retired now, will say, you know, there was the day we could just hang the sign and people would come. We've moved past that. We are no longer able to just hang the sign and have people come. We need to talk about the industry, talk about the opportunity, and we are getting better. And as Sam said before, you know, if there's any silver lining, I hate to say a silver lining for COVID, but the reality is COVID has brought the importance of manufacturing, has brought the importance of work and workers to the forefront in a way that I don't think anything has in a generation since World War II. And, you know, the importance of manufacturing, from the toilet paper and the meat shortages of last year to the PPE and the vaccines that are going to allow us to reopen the world and resume some semblance of life, and all of the technology and everything in between that has allowed us to continue on. And so manufacturing is more tangible, just like Adam said with the retail. We don't succeed though as a sector if we don't have people in those front lines in the stores and retail who are putting, you know, those products out there and moving the products around. So we as an economy need to really work together and kind of highlight these opportunities and reach all. We can't wait till they're a junior and senior in high school. We got to start in fourth and fifth grade. We got to bring them in and show them the opportunity, and then we've got to help them. There's just too much information for people to navigate all on their own.
Yeah, absolutely. And National Manufacturing Day is such a success all across this country, and great credit to your organization's effort to help rebuild that brand and create greater awareness. And now it's up to us individually to own that, right? And to take responsibility, not just to make it a day, but make it every day to celebrate that concept of work. And I can see Ron nodding on everything you were saying there. So Ron, I'm going to pass the baton to you. And, you know, in these careers, it doesn't have to just be manufacturing, but many careers that are not related to a four-year degree, many parents and counselors think that maybe that might be beneath them. So what do we tell our parents and our counselors and our teachers about the value of work and the whole pathway of work? It's not just a pathway of education. There's a pathway of work that goes along with it.
I tell them my story. I grew up in Oakland, graduated with honors, had the opportunity to go to college, went to a four-year college, came out of college, and spent a good 10 years in corporate America at IBM, Xerox, Exxon, and was a senior VP at Coca-Cola Fountain Sales in Dallas, Texas. And my story goes, I used to get to work every morning at 7 a.m. and wouldn't leave each evening until 7 p.m. And it wasn't because I was just this great employee, it was because I was really trying to learn the industry. And about 3 months into my career, my supervisor called me in and said, Ron, I want you to pack your bags. And I thought, oh my God, I'm getting ready to get fired. And he said, no, I want you to move into Joe's office. Now, no disrespect to anyone on the call, but Joe was a 56-year-old white guy. I was a 27-year-old black guy. He wanted me to replace Joe, who knew his industry, knew his customers, and was very successful. That day, I decided I got to make an exit strategy because I didn't want to work another 30 years only to be replaced by someone that was willing and, more importantly, had to work the additional hours to learn what I already knew. That day, I decided I was going to leave. I ended up going back home to the same bunk bed that I had when I was in the third grade to take over a family janitorial service. And my friends, as well as my coworkers, did the same thing you guys did, and they laughed at me. Conversation in my mind was I was going to double the business every year. Mind you, it was a 5-employee business. My mother, my father, my 2 sisters, and me were the 5 businesses. It was making about $150,000 in annualized revenue each year. I left a corporate job making about $150,000 a year in salary. But between the years of 1989 and 2000, I was able to grow that firm from a 5-man employee to over 1,500. We were the largest black janitorial service in the country. Many times, young people look at careers based upon what they think is sexy, what they think is new, what they think is, you know, this is the wave of the future. There aren't going to be that many new mousetraps created, but manufacturing, the jobs of our parents are going to be, in some case here, today and the future. But what we can take from our corporate responsibility jobs and move that over to our entrepreneur jobs with the same passion and the same technologies that are being implemented with large corporations, that's when you have success. And those are the stories that you can tell young people about, hey, look, it's not about the latest mousetrap. It's about creating systems that you can implement that can make you successful long-term. And I tell that story often, and it really moves young people to say, you know what? I don't have to go into technology. I worked at IBM. I could not even get a job to interview in Silicon Valley to clean the IBM facilities in San Jose. But I was able to eventually buy the companies that were doing the work in San Jose. We've got to be creative, think outside the box, but use the skills that corporate America, that colleges and universities impede upon us, and then make sure that we implement those into our small businesses so that we can change our communities for the future.
First of all, thank you for sharing that story with us. I think all of us were smiling because we are inspired by your journey and the risk-taking or the entrepreneurial spirit that you have personally to take that risk. And I know that that's really hard for a lot of people, right? Because maybe they don't feel like they fit into the organization, or you know, they might not have the support systems behind them in order to make that choice. And I know that happens a lot with young people. And so they feel disconnected from the opportunities that might be out there. And so your message really resonates strongly, and I've been watching the chats back and forth, and that whole entrepreneurial spirit. Maybe I could just ask you to comment on that a little bit, and how do we leverage that type of learning environment to keep young people engaged, that you can do and be whatever you want if you take that risk?
So I ended up reading a book called Why Should White Guys Have All the Fun? And it was about the first Black billionaire, Reginald Gates. And as we read our history, we can now start to implement those own changes in our own lifestyle. Reginald Lewis got there through acquisitions and mergers. And so, you know, as I was trying to develop who I wanted to be in the future, I looked at leaders that were outside of my community to say, how can I take similar steps to make changes in my own lifestyle, in the life of my family, my community, and most importantly, for the 1,500 employees that I had. I just tell young people all the time, how can I say this? 90% of small businesses fail within the first 5 years. So if you're a 19 to 24 year old young person, you're thinking, hey, I want to go open up a business for myself, I say, don't. You're going to fail. You're going to more than likely mess up your parents' credit. You're going to mess up your good name of the business. So go find someone that is doing something very similar to what you think you want to do, and either go volunteer for that small business and earn yourself a job, a career, or more importantly, the ownership of that business. In the Black business community, if you look at the Black Enterprise Top 100 list each year, there are firms that drop off that list every year, not because they weren't good business owners, because they did not have a succession plan. And so I tell young folk, go find yourself a firm that you think you'd love to be able to run. Go work there. If it means volunteering, go volunteer there. But learn as much as you can, implement that into either that business with the skills that many of these young people bring today. It will elevate that company to far heights, much further heights than they can do alone. And you can either earn yourself a job or perhaps take over that business when that owner is prepared to take that next step in life. Yeah. I appreciate being here. I got another call at 3 o'clock, but I did not want to leave this conversation without sharing that story. I'm glad I got the opportunity to do that. But know that if you are a Black-owned business out there or someone that's interested, you can follow us at usblackchambers.org, or you can onboard at byblack.us to find out more information about how to support, how we support our Black businesses across the country.
So, Ron, I know you have to go, and I just want to say on behalf of everyone on the call today, and especially the CDC, that we are, CCD, that we are so grateful for your time and advice today. I have to tell you, in my 30 plus years in education, I've not heard that piece of advice to follow with pursuit of someone that you know has already been successful. I think you've hooked on something there. That is a motivational tool for an employee. You want an engaged employee, hire the ones that want to be the boss, right? So great advice for that. So thank you very much. I'm going to actually play off of that concept. And Carolyn, I want to toss it back to you for a minute, because similarly, we talk a lot about women in manufacturing and maybe women in STEM careers. And that's so important as we think about how do we expand that whole vision for non-traditional career paths. Can you maybe just talk a little bit about why STEM is important and what your organization is doing to help build that bridge of non-traditional career paths?
Sure. Thanks, Bryan. So, 706,000 open jobs, right? We just released the updated talent study with Deloitte. The Institute's been doing that study with them for about 18 years. And last week we put out the new data, but we'll have 4 million jobs to fill by the end of the decade. 2.1 million will go unfilled because we don't have the people. So we have to be, there was a big part of the report this year that included discussion about DE&I. And that's not just because it's the thing that we need to do, of course, it's the morally correct thing to do. Of course, it's the thing we need to do because of the societal conversation, but it's also an arithmetic game. If we are not talking to the full population, we're never going to fill the jobs. So let's talk about women. The biggest gap that we have in the manufacturing sector is gender. And we've known that for quite some time. About a decade ago, the Institute, again, with research with Deloitte, did a study to figure out, okay, why do we have so few women? What is the problem? And what we found was women wanted to have role models, the network, and the community within. And the problem was in manufacturing, they didn't have that. They didn't see the person whose footsteps they could follow in. They didn't have that role model to go and to work with. There's plenty of stories within the sector. I did a panel 2 weeks ago with women who had been in automotive, and they talked about the fact that when they started in the mid-80s, the only female bathroom was in the main lobby of the plant. So they'd have to go all the way across in order to have the women's bathroom. I just recently rewatched Hidden Figures with my daughter, who's 11. And, you know, she was like, why is she running 3 buildings away to go to the bathroom? Well, that was because she was the only Black women's bathroom, and it was several buildings away. So that was in the 60s. Now we have in the 80s still the problem of there's not enough bathrooms for women. So come all the way forward, we're at 29% of the manufacturing workforce today is made up of women. And what we found is that women need to be able to have that network. And through our STEP Women's initiative that we've had now for about a decade, we've been highlighting the women who are leading in the sector and using them as role models and helping them be charged up with and learn in professional development and leadership development to pay it forward to that next generation, to be that inspiration for the next one so that more can follow behind. If we're going to fill these jobs, we have to reach the full population. And one stat that always blows my mind, and I got to do the math to see if with the 706,000 it's still the same, but I'm going to venture that it is. If we close the gender gap by 10% in manufacturing, we will close the skills gap by 50%. Right. So we have to talk about how, right? And I remember my grandfather saying to me, manufacturing is not a job for women. Well, we've all come a long way. If my grandfather were alive, I think he would have a different opinion today. But we have to get that message out there. The welding story from before, John Deere, right? If somebody had intervened, they probably would have sent her away. And as I travel the country and I go to amazing schools like yours, Bryan, you see young women in these programs, and it's inspiring, right? And we have to highlight that model and help people see. And this is the same for all underrepresented minorities, but again, in our sector, that is the biggest gap. So I encourage people to join that movement, to participate, because, and I will also say, none of these gaps get filled if you're only talking to that population. So all of our work around women in manufacturing, we need to have men in the room, right? Because we together all have to change that. So do join in, because that's how we're going to be able to fill the skills gap.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm so glad that you brought that up to the forefront, because I never heard that statistic before. If we can close the gender gap by 10%, we can close the skills gap by 50%. That's a really good mindset for all of us to think about. And Adam, I haven't forgotten about you. I want to bring you back into the conversation, because I'm assuming that there's some similarities in the retail industry sector as well. And we also spoke about entrepreneurship. And I know that the National Retail Federation is integrating certifications around that spirit of entrepreneurship, and the Rise Up certificate as an example. And what are you seeing as how do we address the skills gap, and especially bringing in diverse populations?
Yeah, I think, you know, part of it is access. So Rise Up, it's a series of three credentials. We'll be releasing our fourth credential later this summer. So retail industry fundamentals, customer service and sales, and the business of retail operations and profit. And that third one is more of that entrepreneurial one. It's like everything that it takes to run a retail business or business in general, marketing, merchandising, inventory, workplace safety, all of those things that aren't very customer focused, all of those skills. And the fourth one we'll be launching is gonna be warehouse inventory logistics. So based on all of the warehouse fulfillment center and distribution centers that we hear more and more about as consumers shift more online, and as just goods are shifting more and more, and it's becoming super important to have inventory in the flash of an eye, or you know, whatever you want to call that. So just needing to have more and more of those centers across the country. So what we think is important is one, making sure that when you're taking a training program that you can see yourself in that. So throughout our programs, we make sure that everyone highlighted comes from a variety of ages, a variety of races, a variety of different genders, and just a variety of looks and appearances, right? Whether you might have tattoos or facial hair or, you know, be in a suit, just making sure that people can kind of relate to what they're seeing. We're also, you know, making sure our curriculum is accessible in a sense of, you know, not making it overly complicated, not using really big words that are unnecessarily big, really being breaking down things into simple language. We try to keep our stuff at a seventh or eighth grade reading level, both so it's accessible to everyone, and then those that may not have English as their first language is an opportunity to master English in a different way. And then our assessments, we have one set of our assessments have a Spanish helping translation. So we're testing on skills and not English proficiency. Unfortunately, we can't hit all the languages that we know our students are speaking, but we have a selective Spanish because after a lot of talk, we were told both from our employers and from our training partners that translating the whole curriculum into Spanish would be a disservice for those learners, because eventually if they want to get into a mid-level role, they'll have to have a mastery of English. And so it'd be kind of kicking the can down the road, and it would do a disservice to everyone. So that's where we made that decision. And then we've also made some more content available in an offline format. So those that are serving time in a correctional facility that may not have access to the internet, we've modified our curriculum so that they get the same experience as if someone who does have the internet, but not needing the internet. So we're really working to make sure that the programs that we have are accessible to as many audiences as possible. And then also just pricing at a place that, you know, an individual can go buy one of our credentials for $100. So it's not crazy expensive, and we've really made sure not to make them super long. This is one of the, I think, the challenges that we face. Employers want training that is to the point and short, because if they're providing it, it's just on payroll hours. They have to figure out scheduling. It can get challenging. Education professionals tend to want longer trainings, really look at you know, time in a seat, and can it take an entire semester? And we know as our industry, it's important to provide the skills and the training in the hours that we think is necessary, and not to make them too long. And so in some states, our curriculum isn't really doable because it doesn't fill the number of hours that are required, but we don't want to make it longer just to be able to be eligible in certain states. Cause you know, the goal is to get someone trained in a job. Our introductory retail industry fundamentals, someone can take that online self-paced in 5 hours and then have a certificate and go get, you know, work with our employers that are offering interviews to anyone with that credential. So we hear from workforce centers, like if someone comes in looking for a job, I may never see that person again. So I need to get them immediately signed up and enrolled. And if they can finish that course in the same day and I can give it to them and they walk out, they can go get a job. Where if I enroll them in something and have them come every 6 weeks, they challenging for them to finish. They may be moving, they may have other things that come up in life, they might get a job and not have time to finish it. And so that's another area where we're trying to make it very accessible. There's also a lot more we are doing as an industry as we look at our, you know, advancement within the industry. We're, you know, our foundation is partner with like organizations like Walker Legacy and others to help teach and provide networks for folks to kind of build that network and find themselves getting promoted. We're also doing different diversity workshops for our employers to help them understand some of those things. And we have a lot of brands who've taken very verbal and vocal stands on this, not just in the last year, but for years and have been leaders in this. And again, it's just making sure that people know that that's out there.
Yeah. Well, Adam, you hit on many topics that I think we could build into future agendas as well. Things like time to degree, right? What's the appropriate time frame? The accessibility by populations like the incarcerated, the affordability measure, how do we create access to a variety of individuals? And here's the bottom line, Sam, we don't have to do this alone, correct? You a partnership with so many organizations. Snap-on Incorporated is a part of Scouting America, part of Skills USA, and also in the industry credentialing area with the National Coalition of Certification Centers. So can you just briefly describe why is it important for employers like yours to create these partnerships, and how does that create greater points of access for individual students?
Sure, Bryan. I guess in two words, they work. These programs are the real deal, right? These aren't Potemkin villages. I think what Carolyn was talking about, and Adam and Allyson, as well as NC3 that you mentioned, these are proven programs that are working. The challenge for us, right, is that they also need to scale, and these programs do scale, but we need to scale them exponentially. And I know there's many other programs and a lot of innovation happening in the space among being driven by a lot of people in this conference. That's what excites me about what's happening going forward. I think we have the solutions in our hands. We have the substance in our hands. I think we have to act on it and drive it even further, as has been mentioned before. And the reason that collaboration is so critical to your question, Bryan, is there's so much power that comes out of connecting those dots. That way education isn't operating in isolation from industry and from local government. Really, those dots need to be connected. That's part of what I think Mark and Scott were talking about earlier, about how do you build healthy communities? How do you build the culture? How do you build the economics of it? How do you build the education pathways and so on? I think that becomes very critical to the success is those partnerships. And you know, I think what's most inspiring about it all is the sheer power of seeing it work, whether you're talking about changing communities or whether you're talking about an individual student who is connecting for the first time their individual passions with possible career paths. You know, I'm sure none of us ever get tired of witnessing that among an individual student or even an adult. It's a very powerful moment. But I think in order to achieve that, and in order to achieve the ambitious goals that we have to have drive those collaborations. And I think it speaks to CCD's vision and mission around focusing on career paths and career readiness for all people. And that means across whether it's CTE, four-year degree in a particular category, whatever it might be, we need to be focusing on lifting up more Americans across the board and more people across the board.
Bryan, you're on mute.
You're on mute.
All right, how's that better? During your response, I was bumped off the system and I just had time to get back onto the system, but I caught most of what you said, and it's about the alignment and that these programs are for real. And we only have a few minutes left, but Allyson, I want to ask you just this question around the concept of alignment. And also, is there a place for policy decision makers? You know, CCD is really working on building that alignment and collaboration between industry, education, all level, all sectors. How do we begin to think about what's the policy statements that go along with that? And how can we leverage the voice of industry to help make that a reality?
Yeah, there's a lot of questions in there. I think I'll tackle the last point, which is how do you get more industry to sort of champion the cause of the alignment that's so needed? I think bringing employers into conversations like this, into your coalition, and having us be more aware, and it's not just the people who do philanthropies or government affairs, but HR folks, people who are product developing, like the whole array, and frankly, the leaders of the companies need to be more aware that coalitions like yours exist, I think. That's number one. Number two, knowing specifically what you want from legislation is really critical, knowing which bill, which approach, which whatever it is, so that you can be surgical in your requests. And then finally, I would say, making sure that, this is what I've learned, making sure that political leaders in their districts or in their states, whether it's a governor, a member of Congress, senator, House member, they come and they share in the spotlight of the of not just what the program is, but they actually feel that excitement when that student, the light bulb goes off for their future, and having them share the stage, right? So that they're part of the excitement. When you build a champion on sort of an emotional level beyond just the figures, the data, the projections, and we all of us have been talking a lot about these issues for a long time. What's the breakthrough, right? How do you break through? And for me, I've learned if you create advocacy opportunities across the country back in districts, I'm not saying it breaks through and passes a law every time, but it certainly helps you get further and closer to your goal. But thanks again for having us and looking forward to working with you in the future.
Yeah, absolutely. And we're just out of time. Otherwise, I have another series of questions that I have for everyone, but we'll save those and invite everyone back to the next forum that we have here. I do want to thank each of our panelists for taking the time to be with us, your support for this process that we're going through and helping create a platform or a runway, if you will, for young people and adults to think about career development a little bit differently. And of course, to Leo and Jan and the entire team for giving us the infrastructure to have these conversations. So with that, I want to thank Ron, Carolyn, Sam, Adam, and Allyson again for being part of our panel today. And Jan, I'll turn it back over to you.
Thank you, Bryan, and thank you. A great job as moderating, and to the panel. I think the perspective from industry and the changes just sort of matched and continued the conversation from the first panel. And it's really helping to identify some, not only the broad issues, but some ideas of, you know, how do we move forward